your neighbor as yourself. Mm-hmm. But if you don't love yourself, your neighbor's going to be in a whole lot of trouble. It's hard to love each other when we're struggling to love ourselves. Mm. But God's love for us is not based on merit. Mm. It's based on amazing grace. Mm, mm, mm. It's based on a God who sees us as we really are. Mm. Not the public face we put on for other folk, but sees us as we really are. And it's calling us to remove the veil so that we can see ourselves as we are. To see ourselves, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Because that's how God sees us. And it's all right. Mm. Because if we can love ourselves in that imperfect state, those cracked vessels, that broken way, the way God loves us, that's the love that we can extend to others. Mm. Doesn't matter if that love's imperfect. God will add the perfection. We just have to be able to do it. Without love, the Bible is a series of ancient allegories that may or may not possess any real meaning in our lives today. I don't care what scripture you read. If it is not read through the prism of the inconvenient love of Jesus in your heart, it is absolutely meaningless. Without love in your heart, the Bible can be used to support greed, start wars, justify hate, promote racism, advocate sexism, and tolerate homophobia. Mm. The human condition allows us to take the lower choice, but love forces us to take the higher choice. The human condition makes falling easy within our sights, but love makes us place our emphasis on rising. The human condition makes it easier to go along with the crowd, but the love of Jesus in our heart gives us the courage and the strength to stand alone if need be. That's why the psalmist says, in one's heart are the highways to Zion. If you can't see your way, check your heart. If you have zipper when others are being blessed, check your heart. If you don't have time to stop on Jericho Road, check your heart. If it's easier to see the speck in your neighbor's eye and not focus on the beam in your own eye, check your heart. If you can't love those who you don't like, check your heart. If you can't forgive those who don't deserve forgiveness, even though God has done the exact same thing for you, check your heart. And then finally, if the who is Jesus and the where is our heart, then the why represents the totality of our faith journey. And without the who and the where, there can be no why. The who and the where is why we come to church on Sunday. Why we made a decision to be in community. Why you pray when the facts say you should give up. And it is why you have hope in an otherwise hopeless situation. The answer to our why is because. Because we have a faith that has love as the linchpin that opens the door of possibility, restores hope, that transforms brokenness into wholeness. It is a faith that says the only way we experience resurrection is to first stop by a hill called Calvary. And our why is intrinsically linked to Jesus' why. Why he lived. Why engage in a mission that affirmed everybody. Why no religious doctrine can be so rigid that it trumps the courage to love inconveniently, to sometimes love even when it hurts. That's why he took the lonely and humiliating trek to Calvary. When we read verse 9, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. We really don't understand the depth of that love until we familiarize ourselves with the Good Friday scenario. It's only when we hook up the Good Friday scenario with verse 9, that we realize just how inconvenient and profound the love of Jesus really is, and just how much Jesus is requiring of us if we accept his radical invitation to be followers of his movement. It is the Good Friday scenario where we see that Jesus was let down, just like you were let down. Betrayed, just like you were betrayed. Suffered, just like you have suffered. Died as you will die, only to rise.
that will allow you to overcome the challenges, the obstacles, and the setbacks that confront you even as I speak right now. But the blood cannot be confused with Kool-Aid. It's not some syrupy, oversweetened cinnamon top, but rather it represents a tough determination not only to realize value in us, but also to realize value in others. See, the why unlocks the door to bountiful blessings, the balm of Gilead, the peace that passes all understanding, the joy that tragedy can't eliminate, and amazing grace. You only need to drink from the well of life-giving water one time to know for yourself that God's grace is sufficient. Through our triumphs and our tragedies, our joys and our sorrows, your victories and your defeats, you know that through it all, through it all, through it all, through every dark night, through every valley, that God's grace is sufficient. So why is not optional? It is a lived commitment of what we signed up for. We made the decision to be a follower of Jesus' teaching. That's the deal. Everybody in this room cut with God. You didn't sign up to part the Red Sea or to raise Lazarus from the dead or to feed the multitude, but you signed up to love God with all your heart, mind, and soul. You signed up to love your neighbor as yourself. You signed up to do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. You signed up to love your enemies, bless those that curse you, do good to those that hate you, and pray for those that despitefully use you. Love is not in the fine print. It's right there in paragraph 1, section 8, where it reads, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. And isn't that your signature down at the bottom, co-signed by blood that was shed on Calvary? Not only did you sign up to love, but you did so with the understanding that sometimes the road may get long, the valley may be deep, the burden may be heavy, the pain may feel unbearable, but that's why the commitment to love requires strength and perseverance. But that contract also means that you are backed by the full faith and credit of a triune God that has vowed to be with us always until the end of the ages, offering the same comforting love that we are required to extend to each other. So the who, the where, and the why combine to help us navigate through the rough seas of absurdity, through the barren wastelands of hopelessness, into the calmness of hope and oasis